Hello, welcome to Transatlantic Poetry. This is Transatlantic Poetry organized by way of Kundiman, a collective, an organization from rooted in the U.S. and devoted to the cultivation and the creation of Asian American literature. I'm R.A. Villanueva, and I've curated this reading today under the auspices or in the spirit of Kundiman, in the sense of thinking about all the symbiotic ways that we as poets engage each other and in community. So Kundiman is an organization that's been around since about 2004, and fellows apply to be a part of this organization, and they apply to take part in retreats as well as a larger family of events that go from the summer and onward. It also is at the heart of Kundiman is also a poetry prize. The deadline is the 15th of March this year, so if you have a manuscript and you're rooted in the Asian American experience, you have to submit to that. And they also have a nonfiction intensive, which is going on later on this year, and the deadline is the 1st of March. So there's a lot going on with Kundiman, and it spreads out in a global way today. We have two fantastic, astounding, luminous readers. Cathy Linh, who is in L.A., and she is the author of Split, which won the Kundiman Poetry Prize and is published through Alice James Books. Joining us from Liverpool is Sandeep Parmar, whose most recent collection is Eidolon, and she's a poet and a scholar and a critic, and she's joining us from Liverpool. The format for tonight is each of the readers will read for about 15 minutes. They'll read their own work, they'll read hopefully someone from outside of their collections and who has influenced or who has moved them or complicated their thinking in some way. And then the last part of our gathering this evening will be a Q&A, where you out there, wherever you may be, can submit questions via Q&A on your Google Hangouts page or on Twitter or on Facebook. And if you have thoughts or reactions or pressing concerns, you can pose them to both of our readers and they'll respond in their own brilliant ways. So without further delay, we'll begin by warping over to LA and Cathy Linh. Cathy.
Hi, can you see me? Am I live? Hi everybody. Okay. Am I alive? Can you see me, Ron? Can you? Oh, I'm live. Okay, hi. I just want to say thank you so much for inviting me to this. As you can see, it's noon in LA. It's bright and sunny. 72 degrees Fahrenheit is a high today. I know that that's not the case everywhere else because other places have winter. So I'm going to begin my reading an excerpt from a poem from June Jordan. It's a poem introduced to me by my very good friend Solma Sharif, who went to UC Berkeley and participated in June Jordan's Poetry for the People. And the idea behind that was that you would sort of take sort of courses, and then even as you were coming along, you were mentoring other people along the way, and it was a very beautiful, you know, very powerful community. And her poem on a New Year's Eve, it is very important for me because it reminds me of all the. It reminds me that you know, opportunities like this to connect with other people, these are very precious. We'll never have this particular broadcast ever again. This is a very unique experience, and I'm just very grateful. So I'll begin with June Jordan's words. And this is an excerpt. I've pulled out pieces. So if you want to find it, you can find it online. So June Jordan's On a New Year's Eve. Infinity doesn't interest me, not altogether anymore. I crawl and kneel and grub about. I beg and listen for what can go away as easily as love. or perish like the children running hard on one-way streets. Infinity doesn't interest me. Not anymore. Not even repetition. Your, my, eyelid, or the coloring of sunrise, or all the sky excitement added up is not enough to satisfy this lusting admiration I feel for your brown arm before it moves. Moves, changes up. And even the stars, and even the snow, and even the rain do not amount to much unless these things submit to some disturbance, some derangement, such as when I yield myself belonging to your unmistaken body. It is this time that matters. It is this history I care about, the one we make together, awkward, inconsistent as a lame cat on the loose, but all alive, and all the lives persist, perpetual in jeopardy, persist as scarce as every one of us, as difficult to find or keep, as irreplaceable, as frail as every one of us. And as I watch your arm, your brown arm, just before it moves, I know all things are dear that disappear. All things are dear that disappear. Okay, so I'm going to read some poems. So this is my first book, and it's called Split, and I'm going to read some poems from this. And it's I joke around and call it like my book of trauma-rama, but it talks a lot about sort of my parents' experiences during the Vietnam War and its aftermath. And so the first poem I'm going to read is called Burial, and it's about my visit back to Vietnam. For the first time I was there, I met my grandmother for the first time. And the second time I was there, I visited my grandmother's grave. So this is retelling that experience. Burial. There is the rain, the odor of fresh earth, and you, grandmother, in a box. I bury the distance, 22 years of not meeting you and your knotted hands. I bury your hair, parted to the side and pinned back, your aoyai of crushed velvet, the implements you used to farm, the stroke which claimed your right side, the feeding tube, the toilet seat, the pigs that slept so soundly next to the well, the land you gave up when you remarried, your grief over my grandfather's passing, the war that evaporated your father's legs, the war that crushed your bowls, your childhood home raised by the rutted wheels of an American tank. I bury it all. You learn that nothing stays in this life, not your daughter, not your uncle, not even the dignity of leaving this world with your pants on. The bed sores on your hips were clean and sunken in. What did I know, child who heard you speak only once, and when we met for the first time, tears watered the side of your face. I held your hand and said, Bai Mui. 10 years later, I returned. It rained on your gravesite. In the picture above your tomb, you look just like my mother. We lit the joss sticks and planted them. We kept the encroaching grass at bay. So I used to mourn the sort of like irreversibility of history, but I think in writing poems, I've kind of come to contend with time in a different way. Not only as sort of like this traumatic moving forward, but also a way of looking back, healing, and through the writing, sort of resurrecting people in your life. The next poem is called Pomegranate, and it kind of it deals with the myth of Persephone, and in that myth. It's very interesting because the etymology of the word rape is actually, you know, to be abducted or carried off. And so if you look up stories of Persephone, it's actually, sometimes it'll be called the rape of Persephone. And this book also contends with sort of my experiences of being sexually violated. So just thinking about that archetype and how to go in and insert oneself into a story that so many people know. So here we go, pomegranate. I open my chest and birds flock out. In my mother's garden, roses flare toward the sun, but I am an arrow pointing back. I am Persephone, a virgin abducted. In the underworld, I starve a season while the world wilts into the ghost of a summer backyard, my hunger open and raw. I lay next to a man who did not love me, my body a performance, his body a single eye, a director watching an actress, commanding her to scintillate. I was the clumsy acrobat. When he came, I cracked open like a pomegranate and ate 6 ready seeds. I was the whipping boy. I was thorny barbed wire wound around a muscular heart. And the final poem I'll read from this book is called Gardenia. And so at Kundiman, which is this kind of amazing retreat where Asian American poets gather together, it's at Fordham University in the Bronx, and right across the way, we cross the street, and there's the Brooklyn, the Bronx Botanical Gardens. And, it's a generative space. So what happened was the founder, Sarah Gambito, who's an amazing teacher, took us there and brought us through these prompts and asked us to sort of sit in the garden and consider what it would yield for us. So this is the poem I wrote there, and it's the last poem of the book. So I'll read that. And it was the last poem of the book and the last poem I wrote, and it did feel like a movement toward something new, something embarrassing, which hope, hope is very embarrassing to me, but that's what it was. So, gardenia. O love and fern and sun-spotted holly, O great vase painted with shadows, how must I attend to my life? I was once a white gardenia, pistil and stamen, my many fingered petals, in the center, a spot of mustard like a stain on a napkin. I bird-boned and red-breasted, marked with a spot on my chest. Oh, foxgloves, white as a wedding dress. Oh, bird of a single color, I too can change. Daphne becomes a laurel and is saved from rape. I can crown myself with my own life. Okay, so after writing that book, I thought a lot about sort of the ways that I wrote about sort of physical intimacy with other people as something that was a source of violation, and I sort of wanted to reclaim those spaces. So I started writing erotic poems that were very celebratory, and then and this doesn't have any erotics in it, sorry guys. But this is after, I was watching a movie the other day. It was like from the 60s, and it was some kind of like Asian American, just Asian cinema. And it had a guy smoking a cigarette in bed after, post-coitus. And I was thinking, that's so cliche. But anyway, so this is like not quite, this is violence, not quite the cigarette. So here we go. Postscript. You tell me there aren't enough minutes in a day to miss you. Dissolve into a scene from Wong Kar Wai. Clink of glasses. Two lovers pass silently through rooms. Desire locked away in boxes labeled duty and fidelity. One can go through life as if carried along on a subway train. One can spin secrets like a web and call it home. Catch prey, call it sustenance. The sky draining itself of light. Your tongue a moisture I won't taste until fall. Until the leaves flush into colors like fire. Did you know that my body had been for so long a construction site? That men's hands worked on me. See the blowtorch and sparks. See footprints in the fine dust they never swept up. And I, like a maid, bent over and cleaning with mottled rags. They say that longing is the distance between what we want and what we can have. How I longed for you in six strains, in violins singing high, then groaning low. Your body I kissed into me, your body splayed under me in a sheet of distant moonlight. Thanks for that. So that's so nice to share out with people, something like so tender. So I have one more poem that I'm going to share, and then I can't wait to hear Sandeep's work. So the next poem I wrote, and Kundiman actually helped me with this too, after Ferguson, I think as an organization we were thinking a lot about how to process, how to hold a vigil, hold space for all of the, I think people were very stunned and angry and hurt, and we wanted to create a space where people could do something, I think, and create a, hold a vigil, do something to, in many ways, speak out. During that time, what we did was we had an event, and we also, where people came together to write together, and we also had a virtual component, and I participated in that virtual component where anybody who wanted to respond came together on this Google Doc, you know, like, came together and were writing together. So this is my final poem, and it contends with, it's a personal poem in that it thinks a lot about power and how power affects, has affected my family, our station in the U.S. How does that sort of a little bit, at least think about sort of what happened in Ferguson as well. So even though Ferguson is the kind of spark, it's really kind of like a meditation on power in our lives. Poem before a verdict. Once in Long Beach, when my mother said no English, the solicitor told her to go back to the jungle where she came from. She taught me the names of flowers. Years later, I learned their names in English. Narcissus, rhododendron, chrysanthemum. The words placed me firmly in this country, though I slipped from one language to the other, amphibian. Once as a child, I coughed and ear ached and cried in a new home. Torah, Torah, Torah thundered on the television. Warplanes dropped bombs like so much weight. My parents slept in that blue light. Their eyelids shuddered. I imagined that light to be another country. What do the men see when they say ni hao and konnichiwa? A police officer once aimed his eye up the length of my leg as I descended the subway stairs. What could I do with my body then? If I scratch a perimeter around this body, could I make a country of myself? When I was a girl, my mother was arrested and placed in a cell. The officer did not cuff her in front of us because we surrounded her like small animals reciting the tricks we learned at school. In Vietnam, soldiers called my grandmother Mama-san. She was a lucky one, just one lost daughter and grandchildren who grew limbs in another country where they spoke the language of soldiers. Their eyes shone with the milk their motherland could not afford. Today, I am singing their songs, chorus of my mother's heartbreaks. My father as a soldier in a long ago war. My brother's voice ricocheting through the phone line on October 10th when he was held at gunpoint in Liberty Park. "Don't tell Mom," he says. He wears a black bracelet, etched 1010 to remember. Now I watch as Ferguson awaits a verdict. On the street, the eyewitnesses, in the cold room, the autopsies, in the courtroom, diagrams, and Mike Brown's face, and the faces behind the shields, the officers in riot gear. Soldiers touched my mother's hair. My great-grandfather was cut down by an American plane. The soldiers did not know my family. My mother says, in Vietnam, a life means so little. What does a life mean in America? If smoke is a prayer, I trace its dark rise. If prayers are a way into memory, can I construct a burning image? Can I let my voice go hoarse? Let me light these lit damn words on fire. Thanks.
Hello, everyone. Thank you, Cathy. That was amazing and so moving and really beautiful. And I'm very pleased to be here. Thank you to Ron. And also thank you to Robert as well. I'm going to begin by reading a poem by an author who I'm enjoying very much at the moment. Her name is Karthika Nair, and she's written a feminist kind of revision of the Mahabharata, which of course is a kind of ancient Hindu text, and the cover of the book looks like this, at least in the Indian version, but it's published by ARC Publications in the UK. So this poem is called Constancy 5. What more is there to say? We breathe, we act, we live until we die. There will be more, there may always be more, more thought, more hope, more prayer, more pleas, more planets and comets, more orbits from moons, more oceans with mountains, more scree, more rage, in the rivers, more livid fear, more waves, more trees, more lore, more birds, more arms, their feet more beckoning shores, and yet, more is not enough. Never nearly enough to hold this day in the heart of a palm, to lull today to safety, to stillness, for time does not snag between our lips, for thought just weighs a syllable, for hope leaves no contrails, for prayers deliquesce, for please leave no ashes, for comets care little for you or me, for orbits have no desire for moons, are lighted shadows, for oceans cannot impale red stars, for no mountains could halt today, for rivers will not rise to snare the sun, for trees hurl no branches to tangle the moon, for birds will founder and arms and legs do tire, for no waves stifle divine decrees, for the lore always lies, for the song must end for this day, this one last day, before the battle must blaze white and die, with its colors like ours falling sideways, shredding dry seas with rain, staining indigo, earth once again, for night flows like sand, for night catches like wildfire, for this night is a beast, three lungs, two throats, a belly with barbels, but no eyes nor ears and never skin, its throats spewing anthems of unreason, for this night, tonight, churns living metal mineral souls, old blood, for the battle begins in the night of our fears, for all that is left, for all that is left, to sight, to claim, to own, is a distant shore of yesterday, all that is left to touch, to trace, to memorize, is the tattoo of my breath on your brow, for until we live, we die, we live, we love, we kill, and there is little more to say. It's a brilliant book, and I hope you will all seek it out. I'm going to read a very different kind of mythology. growing up, I grew up, I guess, in a sort of Sikh Punjabi household, and so Hindu mythology never really meant very much to me, though I felt it always should have, but I couldn't keep all of the gods and everything sort of separate. So when I was a kid, my mother took us to the public library, as all good mothers do, and I read the Dallaire's Book of Greek Mythology, which had fantastic paintings, and so I always remember them very vividly, and so Greek mythology was my mythology growing up. And so this book of poems, Eidolon, my second book, is really about a kind of reinterpretation of Helen as a figure who is a kind of maligned figure, but also a figure who has passed through many hands. And she is unfortunately passed through mine in this case, but I've transposed her into modern America and various places. And for me, she's a kind of woman who emphasizes this idea that whether it's race or whether it's experience or whether it's family or whether it's a different kind of mythology, that no narrative need be continuous. So I'm going to read, it's a poem in 50 parts, and I'm going to read a few, and I'll read them straight through. It was not me, but a phantom whose oath, a variable star, moldering in the reliquary, is doubt. I have not unsealed love, its taproot, mouthing blackness, nor seized the fairer woman to purge from her song, this hell house of primogeniture, bookish and pale, quartering what is also its own and only rule, this fire, and the fire that comes from fire. Helen, dispirited, camera-bound. Helen, fetching the paper from the front lawn in her dressing gown a lot of the time, and knowing when the phone will ring seconds before by the click of its current. Demi-goddess, not woman, not god, disembodied like a bowl turned over and its loaf thumping out. Helen, queen of never mind the time, of you can't run on gin for all the everlasting, and such moths broiling airlessly in a sodium bulb, smell of it on her front porch, lights on, home. Waking to a November morning, to pins running across a yardage of wool, or headaches, the circular world disfigured by food. Corn cobs in the sink gleam like teeth up her spine. Hurry up, the bus goes, and its déshabillement goes, loaming on after it. I do not insist that we retain the old names. I would know you ever, light, as the seed. Marketing the day-long détente for a sliver of profit does not appear to bother the kingdom of saints, ascetics, her brothers, Spartans, whose only god is, insert here the death of 11 days. Wash the man by the road, who turns and seeing or not seeing is soundless, animal. Wash him. He is your brother. Enter his encampment of fuel-scarred fabrics and listen to his black pronouncements, void of exhaust. Scramble up the highway's escarpment, inviolate, good. Wash him or be without brothers. Helen denuded. Helen, a place of pallor where silk shrinks around her throat, exits the office, mindless, purposeless walking into and out of, through and over, up and around, into and out of, hands waving, mindless purpose, metal tint to everything. Stysikouros blinded for watching her cross the street, outside and into, the car, horn blaring. U.S. national interests. Matters of vital interest to the United States to include national security, public safety, national economic security, the safe and reliable functioning of critical infrastructure, and the availability of key resources, PPD, Presidential Policy Directive 20, top secret. It has, of course, occurred to me that this conversation is being recorded, but what you say does not anyway belong to me. As a wheel on its axis turns, this book unwitting to itself around the idea of the Whitman. Helen of Sparta, of Troy, in Egypt, of no known address, of no known nationality, refugee of no known conflict, stateless, without property, disappearing under a veil of treason. Helen dethroned, disinherited Helen, at the crossroads of marriage. What love is given to a woman whose father is the king of the gods? Light apple of gold in the grass, inedible in its beauty. Helen is instrumental. Laws permit me to refuse your advances, although I have eaten the salt from your table. As for your hospitality, I like it anywhere just fine, so long as I'm coming or going. Helen is not all, but scattered like grain, vituperate, ghost meaning, to greet herself, to make room for herself at the table, to eat a meal of dry meat and vinegar. Helen is not vital. I am not the Virgin Mother lamenting in the hills above Ephesus. I am the invective injuring these dry plains studded with stone pines. I am the lateral commemorate of war, as the steps up to my hiding place suggest. I am the birther of sacrifice, received back into the earth, heavenly rock face. If you knew my real name, you would not use it so lightly. I am the twins, Castor and Pollux, protectors of Helen, or of her astral double. We ourselves doubled in the heavens, as fate would have it, parted not even in death, strange coinage to be translated across so many master narratives as inseparable from oneself. Go, traveler, before the wind catches up with your ashes. And I'll finish with the final poem. Helen, as a beam of moonlight, caught sideways. Helen, refracted onto thresholds, her reflection a holy cult of high-born women, ululating in bedrooms, gripping the mirror hard that bears her standard. Helen, with beauty like a tightened bow, the window clapping shut like an iron gate. She does the latch, empty, diffuse glow. Now focus on her lithe and loathed silhouette. See if it makes plain how a woman could be mistaken by so many men for a ghost bartered dead by nudist song, even in this unacknowledged light, at this impossible angle. Thanks.
Thank you to Cathy Lynch and to Sandeep. We have this amazing overlap and transposition was one of the words that Sandeep used. In translation across these poems, you have this line from Cathy, I can crown myself with my own life. You have this assertion from Sandeep's persona through Helen, I am the invective. So you have this affirmation, this resistance. It's a visceral and really intelligent poetry we just heard. And so I'm going to begin by the Q&A section. We have a couple of questions that came in through Twitter and through the Q&A section of Google Hangouts. But I want to begin with a question of my own that draws from the first thing that both readers read tonight, which was a poem from somebody else, someone that feels like a mentor text in some way. Cathy read from June Jordan, and Sandeep read from Karthika Nair, I believe is how you pronounce her surname. Is there anyone else that we should read? So we have already an extension and an expansion. Anyone else that we should read or that's moved you each in your writing these days? Cathy, Sandeep?
Okay, well, I'll jump in. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's always so much new stuff that one almost feels like the kind of the stuff that we all know or have experienced. I feel like I have to highlight some really new, exciting things. So I just reviewed Bonnie Capaldeo's book, Measures of Expatriation, which I think is incredible. I think it's an amazing book. I think it's going to do something for British poetry that is desperately needed. So I would say that. And I'm going to think of other things, but Cathy, please jump in.
Hi, I have two books to recommend. The first one is Solma Sharif's Look, and it is coming it's coming this summer. So what she does is, Solma's is an Iranian-American poet who took the U.S. Department of Defense dictionary and in a response to sort of this powerful force sanitizing what should be our language, she took back, she takes back those terms and reinvents them in order to sort of tell narratives of, you know, for example, in the voices of prisoners at Guantanamo, or also like her family's immigration experience as people who kind of were in exile basically because of the revolution in Iran. And the second book I would recommend is Ocean Boone's Night Sky with Exit Wounds. It's going to be out this spring, and he's a Vietnamese American poet, writes very beautiful, lyrical, kind of like this, in some ways I think of the second coming of Lee Young Lee, and it feels very exciting to be in community with another Vietnamese American poet. Growing up, I didn't have a lot of models, so I strongly recommend his. And then one more is Human Winds, This Way to Sugar. He's also a Vietnamese-American poet, and that is off of Bright Book Lady Press, and I believe it was published in 2014. So those are three books I highly recommend. There's always more, but, you know, it's a good start.
Thanks. So I'll go through those titles. So Until the Lions was the first poem of the collection that Sandeep read. Cathy recommended June Jordan's collection, Look, Night Sky with Exit Wounds, and This Way to the Sugar. So you have this beautiful list of titles as well that feels like a found poem in itself. This is a question from Google Hangouts. And the question deals with how family responds to these works. These are the poems, even if we have personas in the poems, they feel very personal. And so the question that's coming from out there, the audience, is how do the subjects of these poems react when they hear or if they recognize themselves in the work?
Okay, so I'm going to respond first because I write so personally. For a long time, I think my writing project was to document my parents' stories, feeling that especially if one thinks of the Vietnam War, especially in a, you know, I grew up in an American context, that the majority of the stories told or received were, they were very, they were of politicians and protesters and GIs, and just, you know, everyday people living in the U.S. sort of looking toward Vietnam and wondering what was happening there and feeling a deep sense of, you know, connection in many ways because, you know, this was, you know, I think it was the last time, you know, Americans were drafted. And just wanting to document and record what I heard around the kitchen table and present it out in English because it didn't seem that these stories were, at least in the literature that I was reading. So, so my family became people I wrote about and not necessarily people that, you know, I shared work with because of the language divide on some level. And also I think in my family dynamic, my parents are very open about their stories, but I feel like there's a way that the movement goes is sort of like, you know, my parents as storyteller and I'm the receiver, and then I am their storyteller and there's an other audience. So the kind of talking back and forth didn't happen until my book was published, when I realized that people were in my life were starting to order this book, and there were things I had not sat down with my parents to sort of have this two-way conversation in order to confront. And I think, you know, I gave, after my book came out, I gave my first reading to my parents and my brothers, and I sent them the manuscript, my brothers the manuscript for the first time about 3 weeks before it was published. And, you know, it was a deep kind of integration because I think my family sort of, or I myself sort of have divided sort of the life of family and the life of writing as two very separate things. And so to have the two collide or collapse, it was very, very moving, very integrating for me.
So I'll just respond to that question as well. The poems that I read were not obviously specifically autobiographical or about my parents, but I think as any good daughter, I transpose my mother onto everything I do. And she finds her way in as well. She's very good like that. So I wrote in my first book very directly about my mother and my father's lives as immigrants and growing up in England and then moving to California and everything else. And then they could sort of recognize themselves. And so I realized I had to be a bit more sort of clever about that in the second book so that they couldn't object. I think I understood more in some ways about my mother perhaps writing about Helen because in some ways... women's lives, I know it's a terribly kind of gendered point, but there are some things that come even from antiquity to us that make sense. And I think that the ways in which women's stories are sometimes questioned and subverted by forces kind of no more powerful than their own, that's something that certainly comes through. There's a wonderful film by Jean-Luc Godard where Mohammed Darwish, the Palestinian poet, is saying, you know, we need Trojan poets, we need poets of Troy, and he of course was one of those voices, a very important voice. And I think that women in some ways, you know, naturally, not just from Euripides and his amazing Trojan women, but women naturally are Trojan sort of voices, even though Helen herself is debatably Trojan, but of course has become Trojan, even though she was Spartan. But that kind of voice of a sub-history, of a culture that is overwritten, I think. And that's my mother's voice within Indian culture and within her family as well, though she's a tremendously powerful person. So that's probably how I would answer that.
So this is a question that came in, and I'm going to, I think it comes from a really astute place, a place of astute listening. And the person in the audience heard a weaving together of multiple languages, French and Vietnamese. And so I think the question at hand is, how important is it to include, or how vital is it for other languages beyond English to make their appearance in your work, even if it's myth or it's a phrase picked up from a grandmother or overheard somewhere? How important are those facets and fragments to each of your work?
Hi again. So I think, I speak and know and understand four languages, two of them not too well, because, you know, one I learned in school. So I speak English, and I'm pretty fluent in that, and Vietnamese is my mother tongue. It's what I learned first. And Spanish is actually, in my context, I grew up in L.A. in Highland Park, which was, when I was growing up, 75% Latino. So even before I took Spanish classes all through high school, my brother's godparents are, Mexican and Salvadorian. And so they're, and then I learned French, in college. But I found that growing up, the ways that I received language were sort of, they were all mixed in. So I actually used to think that certain Spanish words were English. It was just part of, because it was so common in our vocabulary that I didn't actually know that wasn't, growing up, I didn't know that, mocos, for example, is, not English for boogers, right? So I think that it's important for me to replicate that experience instead of sort of trying to standardize and privilege only English to sort of replicate, certain things don't have a very good translation, and I don't want to sort of, in order to make sure that everybody who speaks English understands it, I try as much as possible to get the most accurate rendering down, meaning if the phrase in Vietnamese has no English counterpart, I don't translate it, for example. So, and I think the languages we receive are continually interacting and evolving, and it's important for me to, in some ways, replicate that.
Hello again. It's a very good question, I think, and I'm sure that all poets wish they knew every single possible language, because poets, of course, need languages, the limits of our own languages is something we're constantly butting up against and constantly rethinking. Yes, I obviously speak different languages and grew up with different languages, and I suppose the most important lesson I learned growing up in a household where we spoke Punjabi. And my parents would use that language as a kind of language of silence and sort of secrets and private family loyalties when nobody else could understand us. Is that languages as a kind of system, working across a variety of languages, are ways in which we encode ourselves, ways in which we encode those bonds, that kinship. And we don't even have to do that with different languages. We can do that with certain phrases that we share. So that's something that's very useful to poets, I suppose. I think certainly in the poem certainly in the Eidolon, I'm working with source texts that are written in ancient Greek, which of course I don't unfortunately know. And I suppose in some ways that the difficulty with that is that I'm relying on different kinds of translation. Whether that's kind of literal translation from the ancient Greek, but also versioning. So I engage with Walt Whitman, I engage with H.D., Krista Wolfe as well, and her reworkings of ancient Greek myth and text. But there's a nice kind of common understanding that you come to with these sorts of old stories. Perhaps this is also the case with Karthika Nair's book as well, that Karthika, brilliant, lives in Paris, speaks English, speaks of Indian languages as well. I don't think speaks or knows Sanskrit perhaps as well as she might. But these are stories that have been recycled so many times through our cultural experience and our existence that they find new ways to erupt into meaning in the moment. And so in some ways languages become relevant as a kind of, again, a kind of inherited system of meaning rather than themselves. So, yeah.
That phrase, new ways to erupt into meaning, is quite remarkable. This is another question that I want to pose to both of you. We've been brought together thinking about community and Kundiman, and just now this weekend there were a multiplicity of events centered on writers of color and how writers of color are represented and how writers of color are speaking up in ecosystems of publishing and ecosystems of the academy that maybe don't recognize us, them. And so there's this question that came in about what it means to, or have you ever felt like you had a responsibility to your culture as a bearer of, as a representative, perhaps? Have you felt that way? If so, how do you respond to that or reckon with what might be a pressure? Is it a pressure you take on? Is it one that you reject? So it's a complicated question, but I think a very, very important one.
I think when people talk about the burden of representation, I think that is something that comes about in large part because there is a problem of representation, right? There's some kind of imbalance out there that perhaps certain voices aren't being heard as well as heard as often, and but I, you know, I think that personally, I think that how do I put this? Like, I think that while there may be curiosity or something about certain stories, I've never felt that representing my current stories, for example, was a burden or not something elective. It was a choice that I deliberately wanted to make, and I knew that over time that if that it was less about, okay, let me just back up and just say that I think that it is, for as a person of, or a Vietnamese American person, the way that I mentioned before, that it was hard for me to grow up without models, and I think I had a very strong desire, not because other people wanted it of me, but because I wanted to be able to see in my own writing the models that were lacking. So I think that is, that I don't have a, it doesn't feel like a burden to me. It feels very much like a proactive way to sort of address cultural silences. And it is for me a huge power of writing, the ability to write oneself in to history, write oneself into something that, you know, let's say the word rape, how do you sort of like proactively sort of insert oneself into that large term instead of letting media or movies or other people dictate what that looks like? Just the insertion of one's own experience, I feel like, to me, is a very kind of like redemptive, proactive act that I believe in, but I don't expect anybody else to have that same mission or desire. I think everybody should be free to choose the ways that they represent themselves.
No, and I agree very much with what Cathy has said about choice. I think that's really essential, and obviously, I've written quite a lot elsewhere about identity and representation, those kinds of pressures, and how I personally experience them, and how I think they get manifested in the ways that we think about the canon and the ways in which we teach literature as a kind of culturally defined quantity, which I think is also misguided sometimes. But, you know, I think about kind of Helen, and the nice thing about Helen is that she's infinitely transferable. You know, she is many things. She exists in many different contexts. She's a woman who gets blamed. You can put her anywhere. You know, she'll fit in any culture. You know, it's really convenient in some ways. And I think that kind of transferability is something that is really useful for the poet, and it's certainly always been something really useful for me. My parents were born in India. They moved to England. They moved to Canada. We moved to America. I've had 39 different addresses in my 36 years. I don't belong anywhere. I don't have a home. I don't mind being displaced. My only responsibility is to language. And you know, that's a shifting, moving, expandable thing. But I do think that it's more for me the problem, and that's something that we, you know, talked about at the Race and Poetics conference that we were at this weekend. You know, that conference was happening at a time when there were lots of other activities as well around race, and I think that trying to create a cohesion around how people feel about their identities and how they express those and how they feel those are fostered within a publishing environment is always going to be controversial, but that's good, and we have to be able to disagree about those things, and it has to be an individual choice. So yeah.
We are going to push forward and try to get one question in here, because I think it's a really vital one. The question is, or asking for Sandeep, but also I think, Cathy, this is important for you as well, the question of how do you rework, vivify, how do you reconfigure myths or stories that have such long traditions of reworkings? And I mean, ostensibly that's about Helen of Troy, but also family stories are also getting reworked and processed and metabolized through your own anxieties and hopes. So how do you both deal with that? How do you, what excites you about this process of reworking and refining and making something fresh and new?
Okay, thanks, Ron. I know we're limited on time, so I'll be as quick as possible. I think that it's not something that I consciously thought about. In fact, I was teaching a course on women's writing, which is a great way of thinking about obviously all the ways in which that expands over a kind of female canon. And I was teaching C.D. Wright's amazing book, One with Others, alongside Rashida Madani's poems translated by Marilyn Hacker, Tales of a Severed Head about the kind of Moroccan uprising, and also H.D.'s Helen in Egypt, and just some texts that really seemed to come together around this idea of the female voice and the ways in which that was being configured out as something external to a historical kind of mainstream narrative, the way in which women was a kind of sub-history, in some ways a category of that. So as a way of trying to not attack is the wrong word, but I suppose to try and question a dominant history, the voice of the woman is really important. And out of all of that reading and out of that teaching and working with young women, because women's writing, inevitably all of your students are women, which is kind of great in some ways, and they're all young and they're all really excited. And I was teaching them these texts, the voice of Helen just appeared, and it was like this bizarre kind of muse time period opened up in my life where everything was about Helen. She would kind of wake me up in the middle of the night and I would write, and then when she was finished, the door closed and that was it. And so I don't think it was quite so planned out as all of that, as I was going to, in a kind of scholarly way, approach all of their visions of Helen, even though I did do the scholarly work because I have to. That's who I am. But I think it was more a kind of that she came alive, and she came alive at a certain time for a certain reason to tell me something that I knew or needed to know.
I think it's really interesting when you talked about Helen coming alive. I think that for me, I actually do also use Greek mythology. These are archetypes that I think a lot about, and I think what mythology and things that are archetypal, even for myself growing up in a Catholic tradition, I think those to me are very much mythical. You know, they set for many people a common story that you can access. And so I think the access of the story, the access of an image that's very pervasive, that people understand, and there's a depth and richness to it, is something that in, you know, creating my own work and alluding to it, I feel like the rub is that when it comes alive for me, that's my point of entry. And in going there, you get to, well, some people would not necessarily agree, but I get to, that's the way I do it, sort of resurrect the thing in that story that pertains to me. So that point of entry is that freshness, is that newness, it's that like excitement or spark that can sort of take what is so commonly known and animate it. So I think that's my very deep interest in mythology or archetype or any, even a word that has significant cultural meaning that is overused. It's to me an opportunity to sort of like go in and wrestle with it. And yeah, that's all I have to say.
Okay, so you know what, since we're in the space of provocation and resistance, we're going to go for one more question, and it's one that I have listening to you both tonight, and that is, I think there's so many different modulations that happen in the work, that we have these deep lyrical meditations, we have poems of anger and rage and reflection, and so I'm excited by having you two in conversation. So I want to ask you one more question, and that's asking you, what developments excite you in what you're reading, or in the communities that you're a part of, or even in your students? What do you notice in terms of patterns or frames of mind that seem to be really energizing to you, and that we should take note of as readers of poetry, or as teachers? So what's exciting you? And also, perhaps also, what work still needs doing, do you think?
Okay, well, there is a lot of exciting work, of course. And I don't think that necessarily has to be something that's new. I don't think it necessarily has to be something that is remaking the present moment always. And sometimes that work can be really enduring. I'm just thinking of the work of a very good friend, the Belarusian poet Valjina Mort, who always, I think, surprises me with the way in which she engages with the past and with particularly a kind of Russian language tradition, a tradition that I can't access in the original language. But, you know, we were having a conversation, you know, about her work and her amazing her last book with Carpe Kenyon, The Collected Body, which I could very easily have read from as well today, actually. But the way in which she thinks about kind of the object and color and metaphor. And we were having this conversation about all of the stuff that's going on in America. I was in New York last a couple weeks ago. All the stuff's happening in America around race and poetry, because of course the conversation is much more quiet here. It's much more careful. It's much more kind of localized to certain areas. I live in the Northwest. We don't have those conversations up here. They happen elsewhere. But and we were sort of having this conversation about whether or not, you know, when does one turn off that kind of discourse? When does one just go back to the page and think, I want to produce something that isn't influenced by or affected by the very loud and very important conversations that are being had? And I think to be able to achieve that balance for me as a critic and as a poet does feel like two very different spaces sometimes. However, I will say that there are some poets that I really admire who manage to bring that kind of activism into their poetry. And maybe that's something that I have in some ways yet to do, but somebody like John Kinsella, the Australian poet, you know, he lives, breathes, thinks, eats, acts, sleeps, activism in everything, and is such a brilliant writer and such a brilliant stylist and such an important ethical voice, that to be able to do those things from a perspective that is both personal but also listening carefully, ethically to the world, that is something that I would like to be able to do.
Okay, so what is exciting? And I think there's so much exciting thing that so much excitement happening, and I think for me it happens on at the community level. I think this itself is very exciting. I really appreciate I know this has been going on for a while, but the ability for us to connect to one another through this technology, to broadcast out, to do it, you know, the U.S. and the U.K. I think that, you know, I gave my first international reading this year. It was in Singapore, and learning, and I read with a poet from Hong Kong, and just sort of, I think the ways that I've been so entrenched in American poetry as an entity has been broadened, and I'm excited by that. I think also there's this generation of American poets that are exciting to young people. So what we have is we have a lot of just amazing spoken word that's available on the internet, you know, on YouTube, like Button Poetry, or, you know, some Kundiman fellows were in the most recent issue of Teen Vogue, and like some other people were, you know, at the Late Show. I think that this idea that poetry is dead or it's not something that is accessible to people, to regular people or everyday people, I think that's false. I think that it's sort of a myth that we've created. I was at this poetry convening with a lot of American poetry organizations sitting at one table, and from that we learned that, you know, there's this poem a day that gets sent out by the Academy of American Poets, and it just started a few years ago, and over 300,000 people subscribe to that. 300,000 people get a poem in their mailbox every day. 50 million people visit the Poetry Foundation site annually. So if you're going to tell me that poetry is dead, I feel like perhaps it's just something that we haven't communicated out, that actually it's alive and well and can touch so many lives and is doing that, is currently doing that. So that's something that I find very exciting. So thank you so much.
Thank you to both Cathy and to Sandeep. I feel like even though we're on the internet, if we keep going, something's going to cut off, or we might break the internet. So we're gonna end it there. And I encourage you to connect with Cathy and Cindy. They're both on Twitter, and to read their books. Again, Cathy's most recent book has won multiple awards. It's called Split. Sandeep has a whole body of work, scholarly and critical, and her most recent collection is Eidolon. And I also want to encourage you to look up kundiman.org. This amazing, vital, essential, necessary collective of Asian American writers, both poetry, both poets and fiction writers, and they also have a nonfiction intensive as well this summer for the first time. And thank you to Robert Peake and Transatlantic Poetry. The next reading that we are going to feature on Transatlantic Poetry is Eduardo C. Corral. And Declan Ryan. And that's happening on Saturday, March 19th. That's 8 p.m. UK time. That's 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. That's 12 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. You have no excuse to miss this reading. Thank you so much for tuning in. And we'll see you next time.